Okay, so this is a digital environment that we've created to help dyscalculics, and the idea is that they understand about the relationship between digits and sets, and they understand about what sets are like, how sets contain other sets. You can combine sets or you can split sets. So this is roughly the equivalent of addition and subtraction. And so the children, or indeed adults, start by constructing a set that matches the target set. So here I've done some splitting. I've done some more splitting. I'm quite good at this because I've been practicing. We're running some experiments on this now. The learner will go through all the targets from 2 to 9, and then they'll go on to the next level, and I'll show you what the next level looks like. This is where we try to get the child to recognize the relationship between sets and operations on sets and numerosities of sets. We've got the numbers on here connected to the sets, and the sets are all at the moment colored, so 8 is always brown, and these are the cuisinaire colors. So now I'm trying to make 5, and I can make that by splitting or by combining. So here we're making 5s because that's the target. And well, I haven't done that one very well, have I? So let me just chop one off there. And now I can do a combination to make 5. So notice that there's nobody saying if it's right or wrong, not like a multiple choice questionnaire where you know it's right or wrong. The idea is that you have to construct something. And we think this is really important, because this is the way in which the brain seems to learn most things. It does it by prediction error learning. Let me give you an analogy. Supposing you want to shoot an arrow at a bull, and supposing that you're a bit to the left of the bull. That information tells you that next time you do it, you make the prediction that if I move it a bit to the right, then I should hit the bull. So you make your action is a bit to the right, and let's say you hit the bull. Now, the way in which most games are constructed is to say whether you're right or wrong. So, supposing I aim at the bull and I'm just told that I either hit it or I didn't, I won't know whether I'm a bit too much to the left or a bit too much to the right or a bit too high or a bit too low. So you're not getting enough information. Whereas when you have to construct things, then you can see the results of different actions. So I'm still trying to make 5s here by combining sets and splitting them. Now, one of the things here is something that'd be completely blindingly obvious to most of us. Sets contain other sets, numbers contain other numbers, numbers can be part of other numbers. Now, dyscalculics may not know that, but by playing through this game, they can get a sense of that. What's changed now is that we've got rid of the colors. If you were using colors to help you recognize the numerosity of sets, then you may have to do it a bit differently now. You may, for example, you know it's 9. Let's suppose you don't really know what 9 is and you're trying to make 6. You might not know what 6 is as a partition of 9. So you might go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Ah, okay. So I split there. So you might do some counting. And when kids play this game, a lot of them often do use counting. And counting is good because that means that they're associating the counting words with the sets. So that gives them something else to think about, so to represent. And if they're playing this game with other kids, they're often talking to the other kids about what they're doing, and that really helps them. So here you could see that I've now partitioned a set of 7 into 6 and 1. So you're learning different things when you're doing this. And you have to do it, if you like, thoughtfully. And if you can talk about it, that's even better.
Is this like a game to make people better at mathematics, or is this research for you to gather data? What's actually happening with this little game we've got here?
Well, it's to help people. It was designed to help people. We're running an experiment at the moment to gather data as to whether it really does help. To do that, you not only have to have them playing the game and getting better at playing the game, which you always get better at practice, but we also want to know whether playing this game transfers to classroom skills, like written arithmetic. We want to know whether it's more effective than just ordinary teaching. That's one control. The other control is to use the same objects, but with a multiple choice situation. So instead of constructing 3 plus 1, you simply pick 1 to go with 3 to make a target of 4. We think that's going to be helpful. The next level is where you can combine digits or you can decompose digits. And you have to make a target here.
Right.
So here we have a target of 6. So I have to make 6 out of these numbers. Well, I can't do that. So I have to split one of these up. So here I can take 3 and 3 together to make 6. Now, at this level, you're actually also getting...
So you're still showing sets eventually.
It shows that there are, if you like, sets underneath the numbers. So it's still making the connection between sets and digits. For kids who are still struggling, it's going to help them to see how 5 and 1 together make that 6. And you can see the effect in terms of sets. And you can see it's working quite slowly because we want these kids to actually reflect upon what they're doing. So we don't want things to disappear too fast. We want them to, oh yes, that's 6, that's what I did. So the learner's still getting practice on relating numbers to sets, but it's also seeing how it works just with the numbers.
Is this only useful to someone with this difficulty?
Well, I think it's helpful for early learners, as well as kids with dyscalculia of any age, actually. But we don't know that for sure until we've finished our experiment, which will probably be at the end of this term. So we're running this experiment in 4 schools with quite a lot of kids. And so we'll get quite a lot of data, and so we should be able to tell whether it really works. Here the learner has to just try and do it without the help of sets. But by the time they've got through to this stage, they should actually be, they should actually not need the sets.
What's been the response like? Have you watched young people playing?
I have watched. I've watched young people playing, and I've recorded young people playing it.
Yeah.
Young people enjoy it, even though there are no bells and whistles. I mean, we took a lot of advice from special needs teachers when we were designing this game. And there are, of course, lots and lots, thousands of maths games out there. They all seem to depend upon making a choice rather than constructing something. And they all have lots of stuff on the screen. They might have lots of different numbers representing different aspects of the game. And they've got strange creatures and sounds come and go. And what our special needs teachers told us was something we already expected, which is you don't want the kids to be distracted. They have to focus on what the game is doing. In technical language, you have to align the learner's goal with the teacher's goal. The teacher's goal is for the kids to understand about sets and their relationship with each other, and sets and their relationship with, in this case, digits. And so that's what they should be focusing on. And kids go through the whole series quite happily. So we were running pilots last year in one school with just the kids who were the worst attaining in their first year of school. And all but one of them went all the way through all the levels right to the end. We didn't have a control group because we were just seeing if the game, you know, was liked by kids. Because if it's not liked by kids, you might just as well give up. They're not going to play it. And we've also let kids play the game at home, and some kids will play it for quite a long time at one go. So we think that without any of the distractions, the game is interesting enough for the kids to continue to use it. There might be some kids who don't, and that's one of the things we'll find out in our experiment. And it does this by making a series of noises called chucks. I'm okay, I'm not really good at frog noises. The female will be attracted by...